a beautiful day. So what I want to talk about here, right, is some kind of sort of a topic that shows up in quite a lot of different areas of mathematics, and that's gradient flows. And I want to talk about some problems which come from geometry. So I myself am what I would call myself a geometric analyst. So I work in the theory of PDEs, partial differential equations, which I inspired and use a lot of ideas from geometry. And so also this talk will be quite a mix of some analysis and some motivation from geometry. And we'll often go back to some kind of model problems where we're already going to see some phenomena which are simply too complicated for me to explain for the sort of more general general equations that you might want to study that come from geometry. So let me start by explaining what gradient flows actually are and why we might want to care about them. So first of all, in a lot of situations in life, mathematics, science, and so on, you have some kind of idea what you think is good. You might even have some idea what you think is optimal, and you might have some objects, states, whatever you're interested in. And now in a lot of situations, you would like to do the best thing you can do. So you're looking for optimal objects, optimal states of systems, and so on. So that can be, if you're a geometer like me, or half of me is a geometer, half an analyst, then you might be interested in surfaces, two-dimensional objects, but you might not just want any old surface, but you might want a surface which is special, for example, which has some kind of quantity, is minimizing some kind of quantity. Or you might be interested in a problem from physics where you have a number of particles floating around or having to arrange them. And then you're interested in what the optimal state of such a system of particles is, optimal in the sense that the energy of the system is minimal. Or you might be more interested in spending little money. So you might have some kind of task to achieve, and therefore you're looking for a solution with least possible cost. But in all of these situations, it's a question of, I have a certain given class of objects that I care about. I have a certain quantity that tells me how good my objects are. And my question is now, how can I find the best possible object, best depending on what I want? And that's the purpose of a gradient flow. So roughly speaking, we want to ask, if we're given some kind of object, how should we change this object in order to obtain a minimizer of cost, energy, distance, area, whatever quantity we're interested in. And the idea of a gradient flow is very simple. It basically is, do whatever water does up in the mountains. So the basic idea of the flow is, if you want to reach the bottom of a valley, and you're talking about flowing water, not going hiking, because that's a very dangerous approach otherwise, the quickest way to go to the bottom of a valley is to go downhill following the direction of steepest descent. So that's basically what we want to do. We want to do this not just for problems where you have a function of a few variables, but really for quantities that come from geometry and that are natural to study. But because I want to also explain some mathematics rather than just talk about, oh, there's all of these many results that are fun, but I can't tell you how to prove them, let me also consider just the model problem. So the model problem we're going to consider is the gradient flow in finite dimensions, for example, just gradient flow of a function of two variables. So we're going to consider a function, I always write it as E for energy, which goes here now from Euclidean space R2 into the non-negative numbers, because we're talking about the energy that makes sense. And then if we have some kind of starting point where we sit and we want to decrease energy, then we can use that the change in energy, if I move in the direction V, is given by the derivative, and that's computed as gradient of the energy times direction vector. And now if I want to decrease things fast, I want to know what's the best possible decay I can get. So how can I bound this below? And when do I get the best lower bound here? So I can bound this from below by Cauchy-Schwarz inequality with a product of the norms with a minus sign here. And I know that I have equality in the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality if and only if the vectors are parallel, and because I'm looking for the lower bound, parallel in opposite orientation. So to decrease the energy quickly, you should move in direction of the negative gradient. Doing this decreases the energy according to a very specific formula. Oh, there's an E missing, sorry. Oops. I did delete something shortly before the talk, and I thought I'd probably managed to delete too much. So this is E of U. The time derivative of the energy is, no, this is actually true, sorry. It's too warm, yes. So the time, if I change my initial object by the flow, so I evolve du by dt by the gradient, and I start with an initial time t equals zero state of u zero, then the energy decreases according to d by dt of energy is minus gradient squared. And the hope is now that this gradient flow changes my object into something nicer. So something nicer depends very much on what your sort of final purpose is for this flow. It might be that you really want to go all the way to a critical point, to a minimizer. Then what you have to expect is that you have to do this for a while. And the hope is that actually you converges, if you do it long enough, namely as time goes to infinity, to a limit u infinity, which is a minimizer of your energy, so which is your optimal state. Or more generally, it is a critical point, so some kind of point where the gradient is equal to zero. You shouldn't always expect to get a minimizer, plain and simply, if you start with such a critical point, a point where the derivative is zero, then this point thinks, oh, that's great, it's warm enough, I don't actually have to do anything, I can just sit here, eat ice cream, do nothing, and I'm actually a solution of the gradient flow. So you will always just find a critical point in general, but often there are not that many other critical points around the minimizers, and that's good enough for your purpose. So of course here, if I say hope, what I really mean is I want to prove this. And so what I want to talk about here in this talk is how can we go about proving this? What kind of questions should we ask? And also really what can go wrong with this idea? Can anything go wrong at all? And the type of phenomena that we're going to look at, they can occur already in these model problems from finite dimensionals, just finitely many variables. But basically, whenever you're studying an interesting problem, you first look at the model problem and see what goes wrong there, because everything that goes wrong in a simple situation probably goes wrong in the complicated situation as well. So it's important to understand. The problems that I'm really interested in my own research, they are problems from geometry. And so let me show a few of these geometric variational problems, problems where you try to find an optimal object in geometry by saying optimal is if I minimize something. So let's go back in time and let's go back quite far to some classical problems in geometry. And so the very first sort of problem that you want to consider is the problem of shortest connection. So if I'm given some kind of two-dimensional surface, for example, something like that, or just a flat plane, if you want to make life boring and simple, then what you can do is you can say, well, if I'm having some two-dimensional surface, it makes sense to travel from one point to another. And I should ask whether there's always an optimal way of traveling on a surface. So roughly speaking, what that means is given any two points on my surface, I want to ask, is there a shortest connection between these two points? Or said differently, does the length functional? So instead of energy, we have length now, that's our cost, have a minimum in the set of all curves that go from P1 to P2. So that's sort of the practical purpose. If you're more interested in sort of things like shape and topology and so on, you might not just be interested in connecting two points, but you might be interested in curves that have a certain type of property. And the natural property here to consider is curves which are all so that I can actually connect, deform them to a given curve. So I'm giving myself a closed curve here, and then I'm asking if I look at all curves which I can change, deform into the given curve, is now in this big class, this infinite class of all closed curves with that property that wrap around this handle once, is there a minimizer of lengths? So here I'm talking about minimizing lengths in a given homotopy class of closed curves. And then in the context of gradient flows is of course the question, how do we now do this? How can we actually change a given curve into a curve with minimal lengths, or more generally into a critical point of the length functional? And these critical points are called geodesics. So while this is a relatively new question, so sort of probably about 50, 60 years old, this other question of existence of shortest connections and describing shortest connections is much older. So it goes back to the work of Johann Bernoulli from 1697 already. And then the corresponding equation that characterizes these geodesics, this was written down first by Euler, who actually was a student of Bernoulli when he was, I guess, sort of the age of the participants or even younger than that. And so this is the so-called nowadays Euler-Lagrange equation of geodesics. So those of you who've done some calculus of variations will have seen that often minimizers of some kind of energy can be characterized as solution of differential equations, partial differential equations or ordinary differential equations, which are called Euler-Lagrange equations. And so this Euler-Lagrange equation was written down by Euler. And then for the next problem that I want to consider, it was actually the other guy, namely Lagrange, who first derived this equation. So now we have shortest connections, so one-dimensional objects in two-dimensional spaces. Now the next thing to consider is just go one dimension higher and look at two-dimensional objects in three-dimensional spaces. And what we end up are so-called minimal surfaces. So now what we want to ask is if we're given a curve, a boundary curve in space, so these white curves here in the pictures, can I always find a surface, so a two-dimensional object, which spans these curves in the sense that the boundary of these surfaces that you see as soap film here, the boundary of those is exactly the given curve. So this question goes back to the work of Lagrange, who wrote down the corresponding Euler-Lagrange equations. But nowadays it's known as the so-called plateau problem because of the work of Joseph Plateau, a physicist who observed that these surfaces are in a good approximation given by soap films. So if you look at the soap film, the corresponding elastic energy pretty much agrees with the area. And therefore, the corresponding soap film wants to minimize elastic energy. Everything in physics always wants to minimize energy. So we're looking for these surfaces with minimal surface area. And then, as so often in history, someone invents some kind of definition and it turns out to be confusing for students for hundreds of years. So here, if we're looking at minimal surfaces, they are not actually the minimizers of surfaces, but more generally, just any critical point of the area functional is called a minimal surface. Minimizers being a special case of this. And so in the context of gradient flows, you might now ask, can I now always change a given initial surface into such a minimal surface? For example, leaving the boundary as it is, or if you have some kind of closed surface in a complicated curved target, where all of this is also of interest, you might also just want to change that surface in a nice continuous way. Let me also mention that while these are really, I mean, they very much look like problems from geometry, they were really crucial in the development of what we now know as the modern field of analysis. And in particular, a lot of things in the context of measure theory and integration were really inspired by this calculus of variation. And that was one of the driving forces, this plateau problem for this. And this is also the reason why one of the people who solved this problem, so this was first solved by Douglas and by Rado in 1929, independently by them. And Douglas, so Jesse Douglas, was awarded the very first Fields Medal in mathematics for his resolution of this problem, namely proving that, yes, there always exists a minimizer if I am having just given one particular curve, one curve. So these are two sort of very natural problems in geometry. Let me finally come to the third one, which might not look quite as natural at first, but is just sort of equally important and very nice in general. And that's the case of harmonic maps. Of course, that's also my favorite functional, so I have to mention it. So here we're talking about, we're having some kind of surfaces, we're having some domain we're interested in, and we're interested in functions from a particular domain which satisfy some constraints. So you can, for example, think of having some kind of maybe sort of three-dimensional container here. And in this container, you have all types of material that consist of certain molecules, and these molecules have to be oriented in some particular way. And what you want to do is you want to describe at every point how these molecules are oriented. And you do that by assigning to each point the unit vector of the orientation. So in this situation, you might be interested in taking a map U from this domain that goes into the space where unit vectors live, and unit vectors live in the unit sphere. So that you would map into S2 here. But the general concept of harmonic maps, all you ask for is some kind of domain, and you ask for maps into some kind of target that can be a subset of R3, can be anything. And then you say that the natural way of measuring energy of such maps is to say, I want to call the Dirichlet energy half of the integral gradient squared. Now, the good thing about this energy is that it actually contains a lot of important energies as special cases, and in particular, the corresponding critical points contain the things we've already seen as special cases. So if we have critical points of the energy, these are called harmonic maps, then you've probably all seen special cases, because the special cases is the very simplest partial differential equation you can imagine, and that's Laplace's equation, Laplacian of u is equal to zero. So just in two dimensions, uxx plus uyy is equal to zero. In particular, those of you who like complex analysis will have seen a lot of harmonic maps, because every holomorphic function is a harmonic map as well. And we get this special case in the situation where the target that we map into is simply the real line. So we just have one variable, one value, and we have no constraints. On the other hand, if we make the domain as simple as possible, namely a one-dimensional domain, we end up with geodesics. So if I take a domain which is one-dimensional but closed, so a circle, then going from a circle into any kind of surface that you might consider and looking at minimizing the energy of such a map, you end up with a geodesic. On the other hand, if I go from an interval and I fix my endpoints into whatever target I want, then harmonic maps are simply geodesics which connect my two given points. So this contains the first instance from there. And that's really also how you prove existence of geodesics in general, by looking at the energy, not the lengths. On the other hand, for these minimal surfaces that I mentioned before, you can also see them as harmonic maps if the harmonic maps have some extra property. So if I have a harmonic map that preserves angles, so it's a so-called conformal map, then this will parameterize a minimal surface. So by looking at this energy functional, you actually see a lot of sort of different phenomena, different quantities that you want to consider. So having now mentioned these three problems and having talked about gradient flow, let me quickly mention a little bit about the corresponding gradient flows. So for the first problem, the gradient flow is the so-called curve shortening flow. And what it does is really it shortens the curve. It shrinks everything down eventually to a point if it can. For example, if I look at the curve, just say curve in flat R2, then what this curve shortening flow does is to say, well, this point here is really, it shouldn't go inwards because that's bad for length. It would be much better if I had like sort of a straight connection like that. So what this point should therefore do is it should move outwards. On the other hand, that guy here, it should move inwards because that decreases the length. Similarly, this will move outwards, this will move inwards. So in practical terms, what happens is you evolve the curve according to how your curve is curved, and the right formula is curvature times normal vector. So what that does is, first of all, try to make things convex. So try to take the things which dip in, move them outwards, and then try to make everything nice and round. So what happens with this is that first you're sort of going to something which looks vaguely like that. I'm really bad at drawing, but it's less sort of dipped in. And then in the next step, it's going to become convex. It's also going to shrink at the same time. And then if you continue doing that for a long time or for quite a while, you're going to see it get smaller and smaller, but it also gets rounder and rounder. So in the end, what it does is it shrinks to a tiny, tiny circle and then vanishes to a point. So here, what you're actually going to see is I take an awful curve, I run the flow, it makes it nice, it makes it vanish eventually. But actually, if I were to go in with a sort of magnifying glass here, and as I said, my drawing skills are terrible. If I magnify this, what I'm really going to see in the limit is a round circle. So that tells you that whatever curve you take like that, if you start without self-intersection, you flow it and you scale it up, you see something very nice. So that curve shortening flow, because I'm bad at drawing in one dimension, I'm not even going to try in two dimensions. Mean curvature flow is somewhat similar. This is now for the area functional. And what you're doing is you're evolving your parametrization of a surface by the so-called mean curvature times the normal vector, which has then similar properties, but it's also a lot more complicated, or as mathematicians would say, a lot more fun, because a lot more phenomena happen, a lot more singularities occur, which just means you have a lot more research to do, and so you're happy.
Melanie, there is a question in the chat.
Okay, sorry.
I can read it out if that helps.
Oh yeah, that would be very helpful.
Can you get a problem where the curve splits into two curves?
Not if you're connected initially. No, that can't happen. It's very interesting what can happen if you start with curves which are self-intersecting. So if you start, for example, with a figure eight like that, then you're getting problems and you're getting non-uniqueness of flow. So there's several actually flows which are a solution for this. And I would recommend typing in curve shortening flow animation into YouTube, and you're going to see an example of non-uniqueness and also some very nice examples of solutions. Yes.
And we now also have someone with their hand up. Luca, would you like to unmute?
Yeah, thanks. Sorry. I was just wondering, are these kind of equations like the what kind of regularity do you have to start with in order to get a solution that makes sense? Like, can you, because they seem to be kind of almost like heat equations that smooth things out. So do you have to, like, can you start with any kind of horrible thing or?
That's a really good question. And the answer is it depends on the equation. So if you don't mind, I will explain it for harmonic map flow. I think there it's a bit easier to see. So if we go to this third one, so the harmonic map flow of functions from a domain into N, this gives you a nonlinear heat equation, as you already say. This up here is similarly a nonlinear heat equation. It's just hidden a bit more. But so what you have is DTU is Laplacian, but then you have a second term here, which is quadratic in the gradient. So roughly speaking, the amount of information you need to have for this to be able to solve it is that the corresponding quantity still makes sense as an integrable function. So if you want a smooth solution, then initially you can start with smooth initial data and everything certainly works out. But because you have a heat equation, you have a regularizing effect in there. And it actually turns out that if I have an initial thing, which has just gradient of U0 squared finite, where this gradient here is a so-called weak derivative. So this is something you might learn in a course on Sobolev spaces, maybe next year for some of you, then everything is fine. And solutions exist, solutions smooth out, but you might run into singularities again. But it makes sense to talk about solutions. Yeah. Thank you. So in this situation of harmonic map flow, so you're ending up with this nonlinear heat equation. And the very special situation, of course, is if the target is just Euclidean space or just R, then what you actually get is the heat equation. And you know, for the heat equation, you can start with something extremely rough and it still makes sense to flow. Everything remains nice and smooth. If you're having anything which has a target, which is really some kind of manifold giving you some kind of constraint, like a sphere, then you might run into singularities. It depends on the target that you go into. Just as a fun fact, if your target is non-positively curved, then you can start with very bad initial data and everything will be smooth forever and will actually have very nice behavior. Otherwise, you might end up with singularities, but you get what is called a weak solution in the right Sobolev space, and you can still prove that. So for the sphere, the equation looks like that. You have dtu minus Laplacian of u is gradient squared times u. More generally, there's the so-called second fundamental form coming into play, which is describing the geometry of your target n, if you think as n as a subset of some Euclidean space. You can also, for those of you who know some Riemannian geometry, you can also describe this equation using Christoffel symbols and just having a completely intrinsic formulation. So these are sort of the equations people are interested in. Curve shortening flow tends to be really nice. It tends to not form singularities, at least for closed curves. Mean curvature flow is very interesting because it likes to form singularities and it gives us a lot of work. And harmonic map flow depends on how what your dimension of your domain is. If you look at the case of M one-dimensional for geodesics, it's beautifully behaved, just like curve shortening flow, and no singularities form. In two dimensions, solutions exist. They only form finitely many singularities. And therefore, you can actually classify what happens at singularities. And then as soon as you go higher, things become more complicated, but you can still prove stuff. And it just means there's more work for you guys out there to still prove results, because it's still not completely understood how these flows behave. So, having said this, let me now sort of return back to where we started of why do we want gradient flows, or what can we do with gradient flows in terms of finding critical points. So if I'm interested in that, and if I'm interested in hoping that I can find minimizers of critical points of a function as t goes to infinity, then the right things to ask is, first of all, do I have a chance, as in, does it even make sense for t to go to infinity? Does the solution still exist for time going to infinity? So many of the gradient flows have some smoothing properties. So many of gradient flows, if you start with something nice enough, will exist for a little while, but whether they exist for all times, that's always a bit tricky. I'm not going to say too much about this because this would fill quite a course rather than half an hour. But rather, I'm going to focus on, suppose we have these solutions which exist for all times, can we expect them to do the job? So can we expect that if such solutions exist, that they actually converge when time goes to infinity? And if so, is the limit a minimizer, or at least is it a critical point? Now, before I turn away from this existence, let me just mention that if we care only about the model problem, then life is always good. And that's due to Picard's existence theorem that some of you might have learned about in the theory of differential equation, that guarantees for any system of ordinary differential equations, if the right-hand side is sufficiently nice, what you need is Lipschitz, then solutions will exist unless they actually blow up and go to infinity. And for gradient flows, you cannot have a flow escaping to infinity, at least not in finite time. We're going to see that in a moment. So everything is okay. And then in general, we have gradient flows are described by nonlinear PDEs, and that's the time where the theory of PDEs really becomes important. And so partial differential equations is one of these research fields that, at least depending on where you go to university, you might think it's only a field of pure mathematics or it's only a field of applied mathematics, but it's both pure and applied. There's a huge theory of PDEs. So if you like analysis, if you like courses maybe next year like functional analysis, you're really going to enjoy the theory of PDEs. Of course, at the same time, if you're using PDEs in the applied setting, then it's important to know what we can actually expect. Can we expect solutions? Can we expect uniqueness of solutions? What kind of phenomena can we expect? So certainly a very, just fun thing to study and a very important thing to study as well. This is the theory of PDE. The modern theory is really based on things like integration theory, measure theory, Lebesgue integration, functional analysis and so on. And often you can establish some existence results, as said, sometimes only so-called weak solutions with singularity. So that's all I want to say about existence. And now I want to turn to sort of these two questions of, do solutions converge? If so, do they converge to a critical point? Now, because I want to also not just explain that there's this type of mathematics out there, but I'm not going to explain things properly, let me now, for the second part of the talk, switch the method of giving a talk more to the old-fashioned blackboard talk, or what we do nowadays, and that is give you a little talk with me writing stuff down. I hope this all works out. And you can now see a sheet of paper with my scribbling on it. That all okay? Okay. Because my handwriting on tablet is awful, so I'm not even trying. So let's now consider the convergence of gradient flows. So we want to consider having enough ink to actually do this. This is exciting. Yep. So we're considering, as before, the gradient flow. So we look at the equation dtu is equal minus gradient of the energy of u. And we do this for time in zero infinity. We assume we have a solution which exists for all of that time. Now, what can we say then? So let me first of all recall that the basic fact that we used before is that the energy decays, so d by dt of E, is given by minus gradient squared. Or of course, because the gradient and the time derivative, the velocity, are the same up to a sign, this is the same as minus velocity squared. So this already tells us something, because from this I can now just conclude that if I take this and integrate, and I can integrate all the way to infinity because this solution exists for that long, then this here, this is the same as integral from zero to infinity gradient squared. But more importantly, it's the integral of that thing, and that's a derivative. So my favorite fundamental theorem of calculus will help me out. And I get integral from zero to infinity d by dt of the energy. So that's going to be the energy at the initial time, so E of u zero, minus the limit of the energy t going to infinity E of u of t. And therefore, in particular, that thing is always fine. So when I run a gradient flow, the one thing I know is if things exist for all time, these two integrals here, they are finite. And that already gives me some consequences. So this is all working, whether you're in infinite dimensions or in finite dimensions, it really doesn't matter. So first of all, it tells me we can't escape to infinity in finite time. And the reason for this is if I have a finite time, capital T, then the distance of capital T to my initial state is of course bounded by the amount I travel. So dtu integrated over the corresponding time interval. And now Cauchy-Schwarz comes along and I estimate this by putting in a factor of one. So I get integral from zero to t dtu squared to a half, and then integral of one to a half, so at t to a half. So this is bounded by this formula here. This is bounded by the initial energy of u zero to a half, t to a half. So that's the amount I can travel at most until time t. And that's why gradient flows can't escape to infinity in finite time, and how you get existence, at least for the model problem. On the other hand, of course, as soon as t goes to infinity, that doesn't tell me anything. And that's a real problem. So from this, we can actually still have that the total distance traveled dtu is equal to infinity. And that causes a huge amount of trouble if you're looking at the behavior as t goes to infinity, because you don't know whether you travel only a finite distance. Another consequence, however, is that if, and I'm going to write this as a very, very big if here, because that's going to be the point of the talk. If I know that u of t goes to something, converges in a reasonably nice way, and depending on your equation, if you have functions that might need to be some uniform convergence, that might need to be just convergence in some Sobolev space. It all depends on your problem. But if you converge as t goes to infinity, then what you get as limit will be a critical point. And we're seeing this just from this formula here. So if we have convergence, which is good enough so that u of t going to u infinity makes gradient of the energy of u to converge to gradient of e of u infinity, then if I have this here, this integral being finite for very large times, this quantity is essentially given by the norm of this object. If I have an integral over zero infinity, which is finite, I can't have an integrand that tends to something non-zero. So therefore, anything I pick up is actually going to be okay. And that's generally the fact for gradient flows. If we get convergence, we're fine. So now let's ask, can we get convergence, or really do we always get convergence? And whenever you ask something like that, you should really not ask, do we get this, but what could possibly go wrong? And the main thing which is really causing us problems is this thing. We don't know whether the distance that we travel is finite or is infinite. And first of all, well, I said before, we can't escape to infinity in finite time, but we can actually escape to infinity in infinite time. So the first thing that can go wrong is escape to infinity. So u of t, the norm going to infinity as t goes to infinity, and hence nothing actually converging to something. That is possible. And it's very easy to come up with an example of a function that does this, even in the model problem situation. So if I have R2, and if I look at the corresponding graph of the energy, all I need to do is make it slope nicely and make sort of the infimum be achieved only out at infinity. So if I go for some kind of slope like that, maybe converging, it doesn't matter, exponentially, whatever you like, sort of a nice slide off to infinity, then if I put my point here, it will move out. It will take infinitely long to reach infinity, but it will definitely not converge to something. So that's the bad news. The good news is that, well, that's not really what an energy should be doing. And most energies actually punish norms being large. Or at least they punish it if you work with respect to the right norm. And that's where the difference between having a model problem in finite dimensions. In finite dimensions, there's really all norms are equivalent, all convergences are the same, and I don't have to worry about that. As soon as you're in infinite dimensions, there's a huge amount of choice of what's the right space to work in terms of regularity of functions, for example, what's the right norm to take, and then things, if you take the right norm, often things turn out to be better. So now the good news is we can say that in some sense, many energies are what's called coercive. And they're coercive with respect to the right norm. So coercive means that exactly what I have before can't happen, because if I look at any point V, which is an element of my space, which has norm going to infinity, then also the energy goes to infinity. So forcing the norm to go to infinity forces the energy to go to infinity, and the gradient flow definitely doesn't want to do that. So in that situation, you can't escape to infinity. So let me just mention here that, for example, for the harmonic map, so in this situation, we're looking at the energy of a map U is half the integral of gradient U, so of x squared dx. So then the right space to consider this is to have exactly as much regularity as we need for that to make sense, and then also take that norm. So the right space is going to be called, this is H1, which is called, it's a Sobolev space. Some people also write this as W1, 2, which is sort of the older, the more complicated cousin of L2 that some of you might have seen. So you know that continuous functions are called C0. And then if you add one derivative, it's C1. if you have a function which is integrable, so that would be L2, this would be the functions f, so that integral f squared is finite, then W12 is the same thing, but with one derivative. So these are functions which are f from my domain into the target, so that f is differentiable in a weak sense. So this is called weakly differentiable. And I know that the integral of the corresponding derivative squared and the function squared is fine. And if I'm working in that space, then I have coercivity. So E is coercive with respect to the corresponding H1 norm. So this here will be the H1 norm, at least squared. And this is if my, say, domain and target are bounded. And I leave that to you to prove. It's a one-line proof, because that guy really can't do much bad, a lot of bad things if you're in a bounded situation. So it's coercive with respect to this. So for the analysis, we work with basically H1, but at the same time, the natural gradient flow is defined with respect to the L2 inner product. So I said before, you're actually needing to define a gradient, i.e. we call gradient of energy of U is so that if I multiply this times a test function, then I'm going to get d by dt of the energy of U plus t times h. So this is the inner product with respect to a completely different norm that's used to define the equation. So in a lot of situations, there's actually real subtleties around with respect to, you know, sort of what's the right space I work in, what's the right equation. Usually for gradient flows, you take the L2 inner product to define the flow, and then you find out what the right space is to afterwards work. Okay, so that's a little expedition into the harmonic backflow, but let's get back to now what? If the energy is coercive and nice, can we then get convergence? So let me again ask, if E is coercive and nice, do we get convergence? And now the question is, of course, what do you mean with a nice function? I guess depends very much, again, on our point of view. Most of you would call a nice function maybe something which is at least continuous. I think we can agree on that. We want gradient flow, so the function should at least make sense to take a derivative, so differentiable. Nice might be a bit more, so nice might be a smooth function, derivatives existing for all orders. You might call that nice. That actually turns out to be not nice enough for convergence. And we need the nicest possible behavior, and nice really means analytic, then we get convergence. And then everything works out, at least in finite dimensions. It also works for flows, so for sort of nonlinear heat equations and gradient flows, such as harmonic map flow, if no singularities form, and the current sort of research and something I'm also involved in is trying to find out, can I get convergence when the gradient flow forms singularity? So, and here I still have to put a question mark. It works for some singularity formations, but that's still a work in progress. So let me try to explain what's going on and what's in particular telling me that sort of why is a smooth function not nice enough for it. And let me go back to hills and things flowing down hills. So let's draw a hill which is coercive. So that hill will go to infinity here, then it will do a bump, but then we'll come up again and then goes off to infinity. So that's a nice hill. You can think of this as sort of a two-dimensional hill So let's say this looks like this, maybe rotationally symmetric. Now, if that's a nice hill, i.e. an analytic hill, then if I put a drop of water here or just maybe some ball, then the thing will go down, and it will go down to here, down here. If that's rotationally symmetric, I have a whole circle of minimizers. So I would have infinitely many possible minimizers I could converge to, but from this point, I'm just going to converge to this particular point. If I start somewhere else, I go to another minimizer, but I still converge. Everything is good. Now, how do you take a nice hill and turn it into an interesting hill? Basically, what you do is you get yourself some goats. And then what you end up with is what mathematicians call a hill or with goat tracks. And that's not analytic anymore. So how do goat tracks look like? So from afar, a hill looks the same whether we have goats on it or not. So it's just going to be roughly the same picture. So still looking analytic from afar. But now if you really zoom in a bit closer, so we have this circle of minimizers still, but if you zoom in closer, things are not completely symmetric because you have your goats wandering around and dipping the earth and forming little goat tracks. And these goat tracks can wind around the hill, and they can wind around infinitely often and do this particular behavior. So if you zoom in here, the way the hill really looks like is like this, then it dips down a bit and then comes up again. And then you have all of these dips in height. And if you look here where you approach the minimizer, you can have infinitely many of these wiggles getting smaller and smaller. So everything is still nice and smooth. This is a C infinity function that works. But what it does is if I now start at this point, I'm going to go downhill and spiraling around, and I'm not going to converge to anything because I'm going to basically asymptote to the circle, and I'm not going to converge to just one point. So that's what can go wrong if you're not analytic. Now, if you're analytic, then you don't just need nice pictures, but you have nice theorems which tell you that you have convergence. So in that situation, the theorem actually doesn't come from analysis. It doesn't come from differential geometry either, but it comes from very abstract algebraic geometry that most analysts don't understand anyway. But it's a very useful result in this situation. And that's a theorem of Voyasiewicz already from the 1960s. And this tells you the following in finite dimensions. So if my energy from Rn into the reals is analytic, then we have the following. So given any critical point u star, so we have gradient of the energy of u star is equal to zero, there exists a small neighborhood. So there exists an epsilon positive, and there exists an exponent gamma between a half and one, so that I can bound differences in energies in terms of the gradient at the particular point. So what I get is that the energy of u minus the energy of u star is going to be bounded in terms of the gradient at the corresponding point u with exponent gamma here. And this holds true for every u, so that u is close. So I need the norm of u minus u star less than epsilon. So that's the result of Voyasiewicz. And that's going to be very useful and give us convergence in a minute. Before I do this, you can say, Rn to R, yeah, it's nice, but come on, that's not the interesting variational problems. And so the reason why this result is so important is due to the work of Leon Simon from 82, who said that I don't need a function from Rn to R, but I can actually go for a function which appears all over the place, any kind of integral over a nice domain of a Lagrangian L of u, grad u and x, or also higher derivative, integrated dx, as long as this L Lagrangian has nice properties, so that needs to be analytic and convex. Again, that's a property that most energies actually have. If I have this, then the same thing holds true again. as long as I measure being close enough in a strong way, and what you need is C2 closeness, then you're guaranteed that you have this relationship between energy and the gradient. So in particular, if you are a critical point which is close to another critical point, the two energies actually need to be identical. And so this is sort of back in the 80s, so that's nearly 40 years ago, and the current research is really about Voyer-Sievich estimates with singularities. So for settings with singularities, or settings with sort of changing topology. And so while this is very classical, there's actually a surprising small amount of research on that so far, not because it's not important, but it's always felt that it is difficult. So there's a result of Peter Topping from Warwick from 2004 on harmonic map flow from the sphere to the sphere. So for very specific targets, but for general singularities, that work, there's work of Colding Minicozzi. And of Chodosh and Felix Schulze from Warwick. So that is from 2019, that's 2015. This is on mean curvature flow. And then recently, so that's sort of also where I came into that game, we have a work with Andrea Malchiodi, who is from Pisa, myself, and then Ben Sharp from Leeds. So in 2020 and 21, where we prove Voyer-Sievich estimates and hence convergence for harmonic map flow and for H surfaces for very general settings, but with sort of simple singularities. And hopefully at some point I can remove the simple and change it in a not too complicated in the next step. So finally, I think I have about 5 minutes left and I still haven't proven anything. So let me finally prove that if you have a Voyer-Sievich estimate, you're happy because you get convergence. And because in particular, you don't have to worry about this thing that I said before, the main problem that the length of the curve that you travel on can be infinite, and then therefore you might have this winding behavior. So let me finally claim something and prove something. And the proof is going to be surprisingly quick. It's establishing the inequalities where the work lies. So let's suppose we have a gradient flow. So DTU is minus gradient of the energy of U. And let's suppose this is so that we are in a setting where we have Voyer-Sievich estimates. So I want that the difference of energy, I call this E hat of T, which is the energy at time T minus the final energy. So limit T goes to infinity of E of U of T, that this is so that we have the corresponding estimate. So this satisfies that E hat of T to the gamma is less than or equal to the norm of gradient E of U of T. And this is for some kind of gamma between a half and one. And I claim if that's the case, then I'm actually having that the interval from zero to infinity of DTU is fine. So how do we prove this? Let's hope I don't run out of ink before that. I think I might need to change. So we have minus d by dt of e hat. If I just look at this, then this is just going to be the norm of the gradient of the energy squared, because of course, this is just energy minus a constant. So that works. And now I can also write this as velocity squared, but that's also not what I want. I want to write this as velocity once times norm of gradient. It's all the same, so that's okay. So having this, I can now conclude that if I look at the derivative, not of E hat, but E hat to the right exponent, that that's one minus gamma, I put the minus sign here, then I'm going to get something interesting. So if I take this, I get the one minus gamma, which I recall is positive because gamma is less than one. I get the E hat to the minus gamma, then I get the gradient, norm, and then I get a velocity. And now the quantity I get here, gradient times e hat to the minus gamma, this is actually something I know how large it is, namely this is greater or equal to one. So by this simple trick, I moved from having this square, which I can't deal with, to being able to absorb this and getting that this is all greater or equal one minus gamma norm dtu. So then just integrate and you're done. Because this is a positive number. So we are getting that this integral here is finite. So the conclusion is that in particular, if I look at t to infinity of velocity, so the amount of traveling I can still do after a finite, after a large time t, this goes to zero as t goes to infinity. So we get some convergence. And what we really get is convergence with respect to the norm, usually the L2 norm with respect to which we define the flow. That might not be good enough yet, but it gives us a limiting object and it gives us a starting point. And let me finally conclude that indeed, while those of you who are more interested in actually getting stuff done on a computer, you might still think I'm not going to wait around infinitely long to actually get this flow to do something reasonable. These Voyer-Sievich estimates actually give you more than just it goes to zero somehow, maybe very, very slowly. They really give you rates of convergence. So what you have is that if gamma is less than, greater than a half, you get a rate of convergence from t to infinity of velocity. This behaves like constant times t to the minus alpha, that depends on gamma, where this exponent is 1/2 gamma -1. So an exponent that goes to infinity in case gamma goes to a half. So you can get very high exponents sometimes. And in the situation where gamma is a half, life is even better because then you would get what most people think is probably the best convergence you can hope for real in real life. And that's exponential convergence. So this actually converges like an e to the minus. And therefore, while convergence really only happens as t goes to infinity, already after a reasonable time, the gradient flow will actually give you a very good approximation to what you want. And with this, I thank you for your attention and I hope you have lots of questions.
Thank you very much, Melanie, for a really interesting and beautiful lecture. Let me stop the recording before we do the questions. I will do that.